Hello everyone, a very good morning to all of you. I hope you all are doing well. Welcome to the Wellness Webinar Series by Environmental Design Solutions. EDS is a sustainability advisory firm focusing on the built environment. Since its inception in 2003, EDS has worked on over 400 green building, workplace wellness, and energy efficiency projects worldwide. The Health and Sustainability Division at EDS consists of experts working on innovative work environments and creating supportive workplaces to boost health and productivity. This is the second episode that has been curated by them on workplace wellness. My name is Medha. I will be the moderator for this session. The topic of the webinar is attributes of psychological well-being in the built environment. As we all know, the pandemic has severely affected the workplace environment. We are entering a whole new era of workplace dynamics that will not only focus on occupant hygiene and safety, but also on psychological well-being of the employees. Keeping this in mind, the webinar will be focusing on various direct and indirect factors and talk about how these factors of the built environment contribute to wellness. Purposeful implementation of policies and design can help achieve a safe and healthy workspace in the post-pandemic era. The webinar will lay down guidelines for organizations to develop a comprehensive plan that promotes positivity and boosts productivity. The speakers at this webinar will be Megha Mittal and Ajay Nahar. Megha Mittal is a senior sustainability consultant at Environmental Design Solutions. She has more than 8 years of experience in optimizing design, operations, and resources of buildings to promote low-impact urban development. She firmly believes that good occupant health is a critical measure of an effective, sustainable design, and creating healthy workspaces is the primary focus of her work as part of the health and wellness team. Ajay Nahar is a senior sustainability and health consultant at EDS. His role in the wellness team is to enable active as well as passive strategies endorsing health and well-being in the design and functioning of built environment. Being a sustainability enthusiast, he is committed towards creating a human-centric environment and building a culture of health and wellness. With the introductions in place, we will now begin the webinar. I request you all to keep sending in your questions throughout the webinar so that we can take them up in the end. Over to you, Ajay.
A very good morning to everyone, and thank you so much, Medha, for such a nice briefing about today's discussion. Well, it is almost end of the week, and we already feel like taking it slow. So before starting the discussion, let's do something to relax. And I have something to make us feel relaxed. Just take a deep breath. As we are surrounded by the purest air our lungs have ever experienced, so we must breathe as much as we can. Let's practice this exercise for a few seconds. Just concentrate on your screens and follow the animations. Breathe in. Breathe out. Keep going. So deep breathing has numerous benefits. It detoxifies the body. It brings clarity to your mind. It improves immune system and your blood quality. Breathe in. Breathe out. It maximizes the digestive process. It helps treat depression. It relieves stress. And most importantly, it improves self-image. Breathe out. Breathe in. Breathe out. I'm sure everyone is now feeling relaxed. So let's begin with our webinar. But before, let me tell you about the flow of the webinar. So first, we'll be talking about fundamentals of health and psychological well-being in the background. Then we will be showing you some global stats related to the health and productivity. And then finally, we'll be discussing workplace well-being related to built environment. So what is health? Health is often misinterpreted with illness. People may have poor health without any illness. It is believed that a person who is experiencing severe disorder related to physical or psychological health or visiting psychiatrist or physician frequently, only he or she is having health issues. I think this is a very subtle way of looking at health. It is not a binary thing, one or not, good or bad. There are different degrees of health. If someone is more towards bedside, it becomes severe and may turn into illness. And if someone has issues but is able to manage their physical as well as mental state, then it's perfectly fine. As per WHO, health is a state of complete physical, psychological and social well-being and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. And if you come to the psychological well-being, then any factor which affects individual's abilities, does not allow him or her to cope up with normal stresses of life and reduces his overall productivity, may harm individual's psychological well-being and gives rise to the illness. The factors could be anything that surrounds you. Your workplace environment is the host of various such factors. Now, we need to understand kind of illness and disorders which are being experienced in the built environment. So like any other physical illness, psychological illness in workplaces begins with a symptom. That symptom individually or with group of symptoms represents a disorder. Some of the common disorders are anxiety, depression, alcohol and drug use, eating disorder, and SAD. Yes, it is SAD, S-A-D. You know, it is an actual disorder and it has got full form also. Seasonal affective disorder. It is technically depression due to reduced daylight during fall, winter and early spring months, and it is common among the countries which are far from equator. So I hope I am not trying to make you feel sick in any way, but it is necessary to understand few things and disorders before we move ahead. So now let's understand the global burden of health diseases in terms of healthy life and productive years lost. So the available data of global burden of any diseases is measured in terms of daily. So daily stands for the disability adjusted life years. It is a tool which determines how much healthy life is lost due to particular disorder or disease. It considers not only the mortality associated with a disorder, but also years lived with disability. As it is shown in the image, a person's productive life is not just lost because of early death, it is also lost due to the disease or disabilities. Here the gray band represents the productive and healthy lifespan of a person and orange bands represents years lived with diseases or disabilities. So let's talk about some global figures now. Although health and figures never go together, be it physical, psychological, whatever, I'm sure all the managers can relate with this fact definitely. So, as per the Institute of Health Metrics and Evaluation, in terms of daily, mental health and substance use disorders makes around 5% of the global burden of disease, which means out of total 5% of the productive years are just lost because of such kind of health issues. Unfortunately, it reaches up to 10% in several countries. And most important thing is that large share of these burden is contributed by workplace illness. Also, there are few more causes of concern. As per WHO, the global economy loses about $1 trillion per year in productivity due to depression and anxiety disorders, which is approximately equal to the GDP of Indonesia. Worldwide, 139 countries have policies related to psychological health, but the irony is that only less than half of them consider it in human rights conventions. As per the WHO report, by end of 2020, roughly 20% Indian population will suffer from some form of depression, anxiety, etc. So, which is a serious concern for a developing country. So by now, we have understood that psychological illness is a global threat. We need to find out the reasons behind illness so that an integrated approach can be adopted to minimize its impact in built environment. So as per WHO, an individual's state of psychological well-being is driven by a host of complex processes, which are collectively a result of brain's response to various internal and external conditions. It says internal conditions are likely to be affected my individual's personal affairs such as family, financials, demography, and external conditions are likely to be affected by environmental factors. Referring to the Venn diagram here, it is shown that individuals' attributes and behavior and socioeconomic circumstances are related to internal conditions, whereas environmental factors are related to external conditions. And if we further talk about external conditions, it refers to our built environment, where we spend approximately 90% of our time. So it is needless to say that built environment impacts our psychological well-being. Let's discuss the factors associated with it in our next slides. So multiple factors are associated with built environment, which directly or indirectly affects occupants' health. The direct factors includes air, surrounding light, noise, building design, whereas indirect factors includes all the psychological parameters such as social support, control over the surrounding, restoration, family support, etc. Let's begin discussing each factor, how they impact our state of mind based on the research studies and findings, and what are the possible solutions on design, operations, and policy level to address them. So the first direct factor is indoor air quality. As per the WHO's report, worldwide 9 out of 10 people inhale polluted air, which may lead to various kinds of diseases, including psychological health issues. Air pollution is caused due to presence of various pollutants such as PM particles, SOx, NOx, VOCs, etc. And as per the studies, PM2.5 induces inflammation and oxidative stress in the brain, which is a major cause of depression. Also, every one standard deviation rise in particulate matter over an average PM2.5 concentration increases the likelihood of having illness by more than 6%. One can imagine depression symptoms observed in worst hit cities like Delhi, where absolute PM2.5 concentration could reach up to more than 300 microgram per meter cube, which should be around 15 as per the NAAQS standard. Besides this, other pollutants mainly present in vehicular exhaust also adds fuel to the mental illness. Nitrogen oxides, which are mainly released from vehicular exhaust, negatively affect both physical and psychological. As per these findings, the rate of depression is 2 times higher for each 10 microgram per meter cube increase in the nitric oxide level. The important thing is nitrogen oxides are generated from indoor pollution activities as well, such as smoking, coal, kerosene burning appliances, oven space heating, etc. Now, what are the solutions? So for indoor air quality, the defining parameters could be particulate matter, vehicular exhaust, indoor emissions, mainly VOCs, and fresh air supply. In case of design interventions, there are two basic strategies. One is pollutant source control, in which pollutants are restricted from entering the building using fine or ultra-fine filtration at fresh air intakes, carbon filters at return air paths, dust arresting revolving doors and mats at all the entryways are some proven methods to reduce indoor pollution. Also, blocking envelope leakages of the building using infrared cameras will not only help in achieving better indoor air quality, it will also provide better indoor thermal comfort. Another strategy is providing enhanced ventilation through cross ventilation and demand control ventilation methods. So this will help in dilution of pollutants as well as CO2 concentration in occupied spaces. Now, moving on to the policy and operations level strategy, cleaning schedules of spaces, filters, their frequency, use of non-toxic and less irritant products, pollution control during renovation activities are a few operational strategies which should be rigorously followed to maintain better indoor air quality. There could be some interventions at policy level too, such as penalty on vehicle idling in building premises, regular monitoring and display of indoor as well as ambient air pollution level. So this will help occupants to take precautionary measures. Also, there should be a provision to provide PPEs to the employees going for site visits or any other outdoor activities. So not only during pandemic, but also during peak pollution months. So this will further help to bring down the stress level during working hours. Now, next important factor is light. Our mood, or I should say mental state, is significantly affected by surrounding light, be it artificial or natural light. And as per the findings, that people chronically exposed to shorter hours of daylight suffer sadness, fatigue, and clinical depression. It is very common, I guess. We all must have sensed how our behavior changes when we get exposed to daylight after prolonged working hours in closed environment. It's like your stress starts vaporizing off when you are outdoors. Another important phenomena is associated with artificial light. So why we feel more tired at night when sun starts to set, and why you feel more energized in the morning when it's light? Believe me, I'm not talking about Monday morning or any other day when you get up in hangover. I'm talking about usual working days. So the reason is our body follows certain rhythm, which is synchronized with surrounding light. In a more simpler way, we have an internal clock, which decides our sleep-wake behavior or sleep-wake cycle based on the light that we are exposed to. So this rhythm gets disturbed when we are exposed to artificial light, as it affects our sleep-wake behavior, which causes insomnia, irritability, and other symptoms. So same thing is applicable to our smartphones also. So not only circadian rhythm, exposure to artificial light at night is linked to risk of breast cancer, metabolic disorders, psychiatric and behavioral disorders. So there are some other irritable factors associated with light, such as glare, excessive brightness, inadequate lux level, etc. I should have called them irritating as well, as I couldn't find much information on this. So now, what are the solutions? So with respect to occupants' well-being, the parameters that define the quality of life and quality of light in a space includes qualitative exposure to daylighting and circadian lighting. So accordingly, the design interventions to optimize daylighting in occupied spaces can be achieved through appropriate building orientation, window wall ratio, and use of shading device. The optimization can be streamlined through daylight and shadow analysis methods. Another important strategy is providing circadian rhythm based lighting. So this is generally achieved through intensity tuning, color tuning, and stimulus tuning of lighting fixtures. All these strategies helps in mimicking and perceiving the natural daytime and nighttime cycle of light in the occupied spaces. Currently, only few LEDs have the required provision of tuning colors and intensity according to the wavelength of outdoor light. However, this technology is being further explored by various manufacturers to come out with better customized solution for circadian lighting. At policy level, employees shall be encouraged to work in daylight spaces wherever possible. Creating meeting rooms and breakout areas in daylight zone shall prompt them for the same. Also, to keep individuals' light requirement, there should be a provision for supplemental light fixtures. Further, lux level survey must be conducted on regular basis, and measures should be implemented to maintain required lux level in order to provide visual comfort to the occupants, which ultimately helps in keeping the irritation symptoms away. Now, next important factor is noise. I am sure most of us find it annoying. An alarming fact, as per the CPCB report, is that all major Indian cities violate the maximum noise limit, and it's quite substantial. On an average, it is between 70 to 80 decibel, which is higher than maximum permissible limit of 55 decibel. The problem is that it remains constant throughout the day. And as per the research findings, chronic exposure to sound keeps cortisol, the stress hormone, active all the time and does not allow individuals to feel relaxed. Besides this, possibilities of depression is around 25% higher in people living in areas with high traffic noise. Also in noisy areas, it has been observed that there are increased use of prescription drugs such as tranquilizers and sleeping pills, and an increased frequency of psychiatric symptoms and hospital admissions. So this strongly suggests that adverse health effects are associated with the surrounding noise. So what are the solutions? The defining factor of noise with respect to mental health in workplaces is background noise level. And the common sources of noise in an office space generally are people chatter, equipment noise like HVAC, IT equipment, personal mobile phones, outdoor noises, etc. Now the design interventions for noise reduction in occupied spaces could be categorized into three basic strategies. First one is absorb the noise by using absorptive material on all relevant interior surface walls, floorings, ceilings, etc. Second one is the block the noise by proper zoning of the spaces as per the estimated and measured noise level, and cover the noise by introducing sound masking equipment in noise intensive areas. So for those who don't know about the sound masking, it is a process in which sound generating equipment is used to maintain a certain level of low background noise. It helps in avoiding unwanted sound of people chatter, equipment noise around you, etc. At policy and operation level, employees should be encouraged to hold their meetings and discussion in dedicated meeting rooms. Employees should be encouraged to use low noise vehicles, and I'm sure we all have experienced the annoyance created by the bikes with modified silencers. Also, honking of vehicles should be discouraged in the office premises. Of course, this is not always in the purview of the building management due to location and scale of the offices. But yes, assertive measures can be taken for such noise polluting activities in and around the building. Regular maintenance of the mechanical equipment, running a sound masking system are few operational level interventions to maintain acoustic comfort in workspaces. So now I feel I am becoming a bit noisy, so I should give rest to my voice for my psychological well-being, and I would like to invite my colleague Megha to continue taking care of your well-being in webinar.
Thank you, Ajay, for inviting me on board. A very good morning to all the listeners of this webinar. I hope everybody is getting useful insights regarding built environment and its impact on workplace well-being. Well, so far the impacts of indoor environmental quality has been discussed in these webinars. Now let's find out the impacts of spatial planning and accessibility in our next slides. Many a times, while visiting few buildings, we feel very energetic with positive vibes, whereas we feel intimidated, disappointed, and maybe sick even at the entrance of few other buildings. Also, studies suggest that most people feel better in curved and rounded corner rooms than in sharp edge rectangular rooms. They feel secured in low ceiling rooms and feel anxious in spaces with high ceilings. Also, certain colors and patterns on surfaces are associated with confusion and disorientation. Like the dark colored floor in the image shown looks so dull as it is reflecting very less light in the space. And this dullness induces sadness in occupants. Another important factor is the lack of social bonding at workplaces due to lack of community spaces, green areas, and walkways. So what is the solution? Well, when a building is designed keeping all the psychological aspects in mind, it positively impacts the well-being of the workplace. And these psychological factors are basically stress busters and mood boosters that should be promoted through spatial planning and design. So we have listed a few of these for the healthy lifestyle of occupants at workplaces. First is movement of physical activity like walking, playing indoor or outdoor games. Second is relaxation through reading, listening music, sleeping, meditation, etc. Third is community interaction and support. And fourth is visibility. Now all these can be incorporated in our workplaces with the help of the following design interventions. First two are blending nature and activity rooms with workplaces. Well, these are pretty obvious. All the stress busters that we have listed can be promoted if these become an integral part of the design. It has been observed that safe and walkable landscapes at workplaces coupled with shared services and gathering places form strong social ties. It also encourages physical activity and reduces depression and alcohol abuse. Then comes open office planning and transparent interior walls. Now these promote visibility and interaction in workplaces. These are a must for a healthy interaction culture in the workplaces. Then comes color and texture of interior finishes and shape and scale of the space. Now these design elements are so much more than their functional aspects, as these define the look and feel of the space. And a good composition of these in a space definitely sets a positive tone of the workplace. Last but not the least is the universal accessibility of buildings. Now
I think it promotes something beyond the workplace well-being. I think it promotes a sense of security and sensitivity for its occupants. It shows that their health and well-being is the paramount factor for their employer. It is a statement. Finally, at policy level, any spatial renovation activity should be carried referring to the guidelines of the workplace well-being. So we have come to the end of the direct factors, and now let's discuss the indirect factors. And the first factor is control over surroundings. So what do we mean by having control over our surroundings, and how does it impact the workplace well-being? Let's find out. Control over surroundings is the flexibility to physically adjust the air temperature, space lighting, acoustics, and ergonomics of space as per the comfort and preference. Let alone the bigger things, even smaller things like controlling blinds of the nearby window and adjusting desk light as per convenience gives immense sense of control to the occupant. Otherwise, few studies suggest that symptoms of helplessness and anxiety are developed if an individual does not have control over the surroundings. It says that productivity reduces by 4-6% when their office is overheated or overcooled. So what is the solution? Well, providing flexibility that we just defined is the answer. Of course, it is very difficult to provide control and flexibility at individual level, but at a group level, it is quite doable. So providing flexibility to adjust the environmental parameters of the workspace is the defining parameter here. And we have listed the following four design interventions to facilitate this flexibility. First is providing thermal comfort by creating thermal zones with different temperature ranges for the occupants to choose as per their preference. Second is visual comfort through daylight and artificial lighting controls. Now, movable shading devices on all windows for daylighting control and task lighting with dimmers on all work desks for artificial lighting control. Both will help significantly achieving the preferred visual comfort. Third is providing acoustical comfort by zoning the whole office on the basis of noise levels. It will be very useful for the occupants to choose their preferred noise environment for their work comfort. Now, fourth is providing ergonomic furniture. As all the occupants may not have the same height and body stature, their ergonomic seating requirements may also differ accordingly. So there should be few categories of furniture, especially chairs, to complement the height and build of all the occupants respectively. Interestingly, this factor is along with others very important comfort factor, but unfortunately it is very difficult to find in the offices. Nevertheless, at policy level too, the employees should be informed at the time of their joining about the surrounding control flexibility. This will help them choose their work seat efficiently, and hopefully they will keep their spirits high while working. Now, next indirect factor is creating social support through built environment. Let's find out its details. Now, we know that interactive spaces helps in uplifting the happiness index and positivity in the workplace. And most commonly found interactive spaces in offices are food courts. And their importance can be gauged by a research find that suggests that people, when eat alone due to unavailability of food courts at workplaces, tend to choose unhealthier food. They eat fewer fruits and vegetables and generally eat at irregular times. Basically, they develop an eating disorder due to this loneliness, and this reduces their productivity and creates stress. Another study shows that stressed and reserved employees are more likely to quit, be involved in an accident, experience reduced performance, and incur an average of nearly 46% higher healthcare expenditures compared to their less stressed peers. So providing more social support areas is a solution, and the only defining parameter here. And through design interventions, these spaces shall be made more efficient. Efficient in terms of their reach, size, and ambience. Location and scale makes the space more usable. So they should be planned as per the office noise zones and the number of employees working. Because obviously, a lot of chatter is expected from such spaces. And look and feel of the space should be very vibrant and colorful. So putting up arts and murals on the walls can be very helpful in defining the character of the space. And policy level should also help in reserving these spaces only for social and leisure activities. Now I'm sure everyone is missing their fun lunchtime and a game of foosball with their office colleagues or friends in these testing COVID times. So our next indirect factor is restoration. Now, what is restoration? Well, in simpler terms, it's a combination of physical and mental relaxation, where mental relaxation has more weightage in the equation. And for maintaining the emotional health of a workplace, it is a must. Now, what we found is that few interesting studies support the need of restoration. Like as per one of the study, long working hours and insufficient opportunities for recovery have been found associated with immunological reactions, reduced duration, and negatively impacted circadian rhythm. It says that psychological attachment with work during a break is also associated with increased level of dissatisfaction and increased burnout. Also, many individuals do not even use their vacation time. Just 1 in 4 employees indicate truly unplugging from work while on vacation. So what does it mean? It means restorative spaces are of paramount importance for employees to find their inner peace. This is the core of their efficient selves. And the design interventions include elements that complements this process of restoration for the occupants. So first is inclusion of nature in the spaces. Now any form of nature complements the restoration process beautifully. Also, not just ornamentally, but allocating outdoor green spaces for people to play with hands-on experience of gardening or farming is immensely rejuvenating and calming for them. Second is exclusion of noise from the space itself. As these spaces are more focused on individual restoration, the acoustics of the space should be designed for noise dampening. Also, people looking for peace and relaxation generally avoid very crowded spaces. So these spaces itself should be planned in the silent zones of the office. And therefore, the people visiting to relax in these restorative spaces, even in company or in groups, shall be expected to remain quiet. Few examples of such spaces are sleeping rooms or pods, meditation rooms and yoga rooms, etc. And here also, policy should be helpful in reserving these spaces only for restorative activities. And in no case shall these be used for business-related activities of the office. Now, last but not the least indirect factor is providing family-supported workplaces. Now, there is a huge need to sensitize our employers for their employees, as employees have both financial and emotional responsibilities towards their families. Apart from work, they have a personal life also. So that personal life also needs to be accommodated in their workplace. Otherwise, they carry their emotional baggage at workplaces too. Let me show you some statistics for the same. As per a 2018 survey conducted in USA, 29% of employed parents experience child care breakdowns, which are associated with absenteeism, tardiness, and reduced concentration at work. 45% miss at least one day of work every 6 months because of breakdown in child care, and 65% are late to work or leave work early because of childcare issues. So how can workplaces offer them some sigh of relief? Well, providing few family support spaces is a good beginning in that direction. And the design interventions for this same shall include the following. First is providing resting areas and comforting furniture for pregnant women. Second is providing separate private rooms or cabins to support lactation. And third is providing daycare facilities for supporting the development of toddlers. Fourth is providing proper visitor rooms for supporting visits from family members in general. And at policy level, maintenance and renovation schedules of these family support spaces shall be shared in advance so that the occupants can plan their day accordingly. A workspace supporting the family needs of their employees helps a lot in maintaining their work-life balance. This takes a lot of mental pressure and stress away from them. In fact, it increases their happiness quotient and so does their productivity. Well, so we have come to the end of the indirect factors, and I must say a lot of built environment factors impact the emotional health of its occupants. Now the big question is how to implement these parameters that we just discussed. This is where organizations like International Well Building Institute and Indian Green Building Council come to the rescue. They provide specific frameworks and guidelines as part of their rating systems to help businesses with the implementation part in a comprehensive way. And we at Environmental Design Solutions promote and extend healthy work environment by transforming these building practices, these standards into practices. We assist in feasibility, implementation, performance verification, and continuous monitoring of building performance. I hope this webinar will put some light on making workplaces more robust with respect to their emotional health. Thank you so much. Over to you, Medha.
Thank you, Megha. That was truly very insightful. I especially resonated with your views on the importance of personal and family support in the workplace. They should truly be given importance in a healthy working environment. Now we have a few minutes to take a few audience questions. I will be directing them towards Ajay and Megha. The first question is for Megha. So Megha, how do you think certification helps in attaining well-being in workspaces?
Thank you, Meena, for that question. I think certifications provide a framework, streamlined framework for the workplace well-being of a space, because certifications have structures that caters to all the aspects of building design. So when you certify a building, the process begins from the designing part of the building and it ends to the operations. And in case of certifications that offer workplace well-being, like I just mentioned, these are evidence-based certifications. So not only they will be on paper, there will be people who are going to verify all the factors that we've discussed regarding workplace well-being on sheet. So there will be verification also in the certification. So I hope that satisfies.
Yes, of course. Thank you, Megha. The next question I would like to direct to Ajay. So Ajay, considering the COVID situation, how is well-being being tackled psychologically in the workspaces as of now? What are your views on this? Ajay, are you here?
Hello, Medha, can you hear me?
Yes, Ajay, I can hear you.
Yeah.
Should I repeat the question for you?
No, I have any questions.
Okay.
So the question is how pandemic actually has affected all workplace well-being, and it actually affected the normal workplace well-being. So I think during COVID or post-COVID, actually a smooth transition should take place from one comfort zone to another comfort zone. So first thing is, in workplaces, first thing is to provide, a healthier and safer environment to the employees or to the occupants, like providing PPEs, as we mentioned in our air quality section, providing PPEs at individual level in workspaces would be helpful to ensure the employee safety. Second one is more nature incorporation in the building premises or within the building. And one suggestion is you can do one thing, if the offices or building premises have lawns or gardens, so what they can do, they can discuss the meetings or business in the lawns and gardens during gardening activity. Actually, it helps in burying the stress while working. So this is my take right on that.
Sure, Richard. There is also one very personal, and I think something that all of us would like to know. Megha, how do you take care of your mental well-being at your workplace? What do you do for it? What are your personal interventions?
Thank you, Megha, for that question. Well, for my personal well-being, I try to maintain a schedule of my work. I have to balance my work life in such a way that I do not, there are only fixed working hours that I work, and I do not extend them. I try to maintain that schedule. Like the saying, early to bed, early to rise, makes a person healthy, wealthy, and wise. I try to maintain that that schedule. That's for me.
We have time for one last question that I would like to ask Ajay. Ajay, what do you think are the factors that you mentioned in your presentation? Are these factors measurable?
Okay, so the factors, direct factors, all are measurable, like air, surrounding light, noise, they are measurable. But the indirect factors are not measurable, like they are not absolute. So they can be measured by surveys. So if you have control over this, like we talk about the control over the surrounding, so the surveys can help in measuring the effect of that thing and importance of that thing. So I think for direct factor, we have measuring equipments. Of indirect factors, survey will help, I guess.
Right, Ajay, thank you for your answer. With that, we come to an end of today's webinar. I would like to thank you all for tuning in to this session. I hope that all of you will be taking back good information on psychological well-being and its implementation strategies. To conclude, I would like to request you all to follow EDS on our social media platforms. We are on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Instagram. Here you will find all the updates on our upcoming webinars. Hope to see you all very soon. Take care and keep safe. Thank you.